Hi to all the family at Rhema Church South Coast there. What a privilege and pleasure it is to have you part of our family. What a blessing you are. All the way along the coast of lovely Natal. And I really, really appreciate Pastor Larry, his beautiful wife Mandy, and Claude. They've been a great blessing over the years to us, and to me in particular personally, and to the leadership of the Rhema family churches. And my, what God has done in the past 5 years, it's been outstanding. But it's only the beginning. I know you've sown, I know you've prayed, I know that you've had to be patient and persistent, but thank God the time has come now where God will grow the church not only in their hearts, but in numbers, and that the facility will be packed. We're excited about it. We're excited about the leadership potential and blessing that you have towards the Rhema family churches and to our churches across the country. Thank you for your faithfulness, persistence, commitment, and your love. And my prayer is that your love for people will be extended everywhere. And as the church as a whole sees people's needs, they will meet it in Jesus' name. Have a great celebration. Have a great day. It's time to rejoice in what God is doing for you. God bless you. We love you very much.
Praise the Lord. As goes with hosting lovely events like this, doesn't go without its challenges, and so our light computer board has decided to go its own way tonight. So just bear with us, but how many know God is so faithful tonight? And we're so privileged, we're so thankful tonight that He's given us our own building. And how many know the local church is the hope of the world? Can you say amen? And the reason God places a church, a local church in an area, is so that they can impact and make a difference in the lives of people. Because you know what? God is crazy about people. Can you say amen? And so we love to have all of you here tonight. And if I just start just welcoming everybody and some of the guests that are here tonight, we wouldn't have time to preach. And so I know that's the most important thing tonight. Amen? It's to worship Jesus and to share the Word of God. And so just what we want to say tonight to all of you here, thank you so much for coming out tonight, middle of the week, and just coming to celebrate and just to honor God for everything that He's done. Can you say amen? We want to just give a special welcome to Pastor Don and Nomsa Phillips. They pastor a great church in Mthatha. And Pastor Don is the chairman of the Rhema family of churches. And we so appreciate you making an effort to be here tonight. Pastor Chris and Brenda, our secretary, if you could just give them a round of applause, just of appreciation. Thank you so much. And then also we have some honored guests. Our local counselors in this area have come tonight just to support and celebrate us. And they played a pivotal role in helping us get all the approvals and all the things we needed. So could you just give us a wave there? We're just going to welcome all of you guys. Thank you so much for being here tonight. George and all the rest of you guys. Jenny, thank you so much. We really appreciate you guys. And we're grateful that you are here tonight. Well, without further ado, I'm going to just greet and welcome Pastor Anthony and Laurel here, my pastors. And I'm here today because of their faithfulness and because of their obedience to God. Can you say amen? And so could you just stand, Pastor Anthony and Laurel? We just want to honor you tonight. We appreciate you. We love you. We thank you for everything that you've laid down so that we could be here tonight. And, you know, they sowed us down here to start this church. There have been a few times when I wondered why they did that. You know, was it to get rid of me or was it because they loved me? Just occasionally. But no, we really know God has a purpose. And Pastor Anthony's come tonight. We're so privileged that he's going to be sharing the word with us tonight. And so as he comes, could we just give him just one more round of applause of appreciation. Thank you so much.
Praise the Lord. Amen. What a great honor for me to stand here in front of an awesome crowd of people like you guys tonight. I just sense in my spirit that this is a new thing God's doing. something new is going to break forth. Can you say amen? Amen. And we're excited about what God... Yes, come on, let's give the Lord another hand tonight. Amen. Bless His holy name tonight. Amen. We serve a good God tonight. And we thank Him for His goodness and His mercy tonight. And His loving kindness. And let me just say this. I never planted Larry yet to get rid of him. I actually had to stop him at times. Can you say amen? I just let him grow a bit so he wouldn't make a mess up. Can you say amen? Praise the Lord. So we are really grateful to be here. Thank you for allowing me the honor to come and preach here tonight and stand before you. I feel like the Apostle Paul when he said, you know, I'm the least of all the brethren. So it's only this grace that's been given to me that I should preach the gospel. Amen. But tonight I pray what John the Baptist prayed. He said, Lord, you must increase and we must decrease. Let it everything we do tonight be about Jesus and Him glorified through His Word as we bring a presence of God into our community and the wonderful things God is doing. Amen. And so tonight I want to speak to you about a subject on connection. Everything about us is connection. Everything. We are born from connection, into connection, and to be connected. Can you say amen? I was thinking today, you know, when a mother carries a baby, they've got the umbilical cord. And that baby is connected to the umbilical cord, and that umbilical cord brings life and sustenance into that child. And then what happens is once the child is born, they cut that and then they clip it. And then the child falls into its mother's arms and it starts getting milk from mama. And all the good moms in the house will tell you the longer a child can stay on the mother's breast for feeding, the more it nourishes and grows in life and it's healthier for the child. Can you say amen? So everything tonight about us is connected. And God has created us to connect. You know, we have all types of connections in life. We have people we connect with at work. We have family connections. That's not the mafia connections, amen? We have all different kinds of connections. We have people we connect with here in church and all these kind of things that we connect with. And one of the things that I think has happened to people is this, is people underestimate the potential of connections. They underestimate the power of connection. You know, connections are very powerful. Can you say amen? And we need to understand how powerful they are tonight for us in our lives, because when you are connected to the right people, your life only goes from greatness and it increases. I know this, that I'm connected to people that God's connected me to. They are potentially powerful, and it's through the connections I have with these people that I know where I am tonight. If I was never connected to them, I don't think I would be where I am tonight. Amen. So you must never underestimate connections in your life. Don't underestimate it tonight. Amen. Because the same way that connections are powerful and have a lot of potential in life, you also need to realize tonight that this connection has a devastating effect on your life. That this, you know, I know people. I mean, I've been pastoring in one church 33 years, and I know people that have flourished, and because of something, for whatever reason, they disconnected themselves from the house, or they disconnected themselves from the things of God, and their lives have not increased but gone down. So there's a fact that we need to realize tonight, and I want to just spend some of the time I have tonight, I don't know what time I started, tonight, just to speak to you about connections, the principles of connection and disconnection from the Word of God. And we find here that there's... Let me stop here and just say that this is a perfect example, so I can share this with you tonight. Come up here, Brother Giles. Hallelujah. Come on up here. Let's give me your hand and you can come right up over here. There you go. This hand I shook many, many years ago. Let me just share this with you, because I think it's very appropriate because I'm speaking about connections. You know, this man here had a lot to do with me coming into ministry. Did you know that? Because when he came out of a mainline denomination, there was no church in the south of Johannesburg or a charismatic church. And him and one or two other guys decided to invite me to come to their house to preach. And we came and preached. Now, Watch this. Because I was connected to him, he invited me and then invited me again. And then they said, we believe we want to start a church. We started with 20 and 10 left and we went down to 8. Can you say amen? Brother. But you know what? If God never connected me with this man, even though people think they're insignificant, your connection, connecting one person to another, connecting to another person, connecting to another person, can change people's destiny. And he connected with me, and I want to say this, that our church in Rhema South was birthed out of a connection that I had with this man. Amen. There you go. Hallelujah. You can be seated, brother. I thought I'd just share that with you tonight. Now, so Pastor Larry came, and God connected me with Pastor Larry. Jesus, I've never been the same again. But anyway. Pastor Larry. Now, watch this now. Pastor Larry served in our church for many years. Faithful, did excellent, excelled in everything he did. And he came to me once, and he said, you know, Pastor, I feel like I want to go and start a church down in Natal. And I said to him, well, let's pray about it. And he looked at me strange, because I know he was chomping at the bits to go. So I said, let's pray about it. And for a whole year, nothing happened. Is that right? This man, yeah, retired. The same man, Giles, retired down to this place. And he phoned me, and he spoke to me one day, without him knowing about this talking here at all. He said, you know what, Pastor? God's going to start a Rhema in Margate, in the South Coast. God's going to start it. And now God connected him into this church. Now watch the connections, how they happen in life. Connections are so powerful. We must never underestimate our connections. Can you say amen? And we can see this. We want to talk about that, the principles of connection and disconnection. Now, in the Word of God, yeah, is probably the most powerful verses in the Bible about connection. It says this in John 15:4. Jesus speaks and he says, remain in me and I will remain in you. For a branch cannot produce fruit if it's severed from the vine. You cannot be fruitful unless you remain in me. Yes, I am the vine and you are the branches. Those that remain in me and I in him will produce much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. Anyone who does not remain in me is thrown away like a useless branch and withers. Such branches are gathered into a pile and burned. But if you remain in me and my words remain in you, you will ask anything you want and it shall be granted. When you produce much fruit, you are truly my disciples. This brings great glory to my Father. Yeah, Jesus talks about the greatest connection mankind could ever have, and that is with Jesus himself. He is the vine, and we are the branches. Can you say amen? And we have that connection. But you know the strange thing that he talks about? Yeah, there's some things that he talks about in the connection. When you are connected to Christ, notice what it says here. It says, when you are connected to him, your life becomes fruitful. Your life becomes fruitful. Amen? Not only that, he says that if you remain in me, I will remain in you. Now, a nugget that we need to understand about this verse of Scripture is this. Whatever you remain in, will remain in you. Whatever you remain in, will remain in you. If you want to remain in your old lifestyle will remain in you. He says you've got to remain in me. Can you say amen? That means not just a Sunday visit. That means a lifestyle, abiding, remaining in Christ. Can you say amen? Because what you remain in, remains in you. So we need to understand how important is the things that you and I remain in. In verses 5 in the New Living Translation, it says this. Jesus says, yes, I am the vine, and you the branches. Those that remain in me and I in him produce much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Apart from me, you can do nothing. You know, we need to realize how important it is to abide in Christ. How important it is for us to be united to him. Because it tells us here, you know, if we start thinking we can do things on our own, and that the things we accomplish we do in our own ability, You know what happens? We start slowly severing that relationship with Christ as the vine and the branch. So we need to understand that. We need to understand this tonight. That God is big on fruitfulness. In actual fact, I want to say this to you tonight. God expects you to be fruitful. There's no excuse. Because He says, if you abide in me, and I in you, you'll bring forth what? Much fruit. God's big on fruit. In actual fact, He created you to be fruitful. Can you say amen to that? In Genesis chapter 1, the very first thing God said to man after He created him, He said this. He said, God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful. The first thing He commands us, be fruitful. Look at somebody and say, be fruitful. Not only that, what do you got to do? Multiply, replenish the earth. Now some people take that personally. Can you say amen? Then they do the whole thing for all of us. But it speaks about fruitfulness. And our lives becoming fruitful in the things that God wants us to do. Because without Him we can do nothing. You see, sometimes we think we can do it in our own strength, but we really can't. And He talks about the branches. He speaks about the fact that branches that don't produce, He cuts off or He prunes. Now, I don't know about you. Have you ever walked past a tree and you see a little branch or a little twig on a tree and you just snap it off like that? Totally dead. It just comes off so easy. And He talks about the fact that we need to be fruitful in our lives. In John 15:2, in the Amplified Bible, it says this. The Bible says this. It says, any branch in me that does not bear fruit, that stops bearing fruit, He cuts away. He trims it off. Takes it away. And He cleanses and repeatedly prunes every branch that continues to bear fruit, to make it bear more and richer and more excellent fruit. You know, God is in the pruning business. Can you say amen? And you know, when God prunes you sometimes, it's not the best time of life when you go through pruning. Amen? I mean, I've had some great prunings in my life, and I tell you what, the only reason why God prunes us is so that we can have more fruit, better fruit, and more excellent fruit. Can you say amen? You know why? Because God's got much more for you. Come on, God's got much more for you. Can you? He loves you so much, He doesn't want you to stay like you are. He wants us to increase, be more fruitful, touch more lives. Can you say amen? So what does He do? He prunes. Now let me tell you the things that God prunes in your life. He deals with dead things. He cuts off dead things. Now, how many of you know, if you don't let go of dead things stop you from being fruitful. Some of us have got to cut off some dead relationships in the past so we can go on and be fruitful in the things of Christ. He cuts off dead things. God keeps on talking to you about cutting off dead things that have got no eternal value. Amen. It's amazing how we give ourselves to things that have got no eternal value. So He cuts them off. Let them go. Can you say amen? Some of us sitting here tonight, you know there are some dead things in life that you need to cut off. Sometimes it's hard to cut off things because some of the things you like are enjoyable, but they are not eternal values and they don't get you anywhere in life. In actual fact, they'll stop you. Can you say amen to that tonight? So He deals with us with dead things. The one thing I want to speak about tonight really is the God connection. The God connection. God connects us with people. God connections are the most valuable connections you have in your life. Listen to me, if I can say this to you tonight, if I leave anything with you tonight, the most important connections in your life are your God connections. Most important. I want to say this to you. God connections are so powerful. And I know this, that through these God connections, I have God connections in my life. I want you to know tonight. And I know that through these God connections in my life, that things have happened in my life. My life has changed because I've been connected to people that God has placed in my life. My life became stable because people that God connected me with. My life became fruitful in things that God, with people that God created me with. Amen? Or connected me with, I should say. And hold on, to your God connection. Hold on to your God connection. Because I want to say this to you. You will always be tempted to cut or disconnect from your God connection. Why? Because the devil wants to disconnect you. You know, how many of you know, if you've been in a relationship long enough, there's always the temptation to cut that relationship for some reason or another. You know, my wife and I have been married 42, 43 years. We're happily married. We're still together. But you know, if I never had a thought in 43 years to say, hey man, I think I want to be single again. I want to cut this thing. Come on, don't look at me like that, you guys. You know, alright, you never do those things. Okay, forgive me, I'm just sharing my heart with you tonight. Is that okay? Been very tempted. The people that God's placed in my life, my God connections, I know. You see, when you have a God connection, you know that you know that you know here. That's the connection God has placed in your life. And I tell you, I have God connections in my life. And over the years in my God connections, there have been times that I have been tempted to break it. There's been times I felt, I don't want to go on with this. But you know what? It doesn't matter what happens when you go through life. We will always have disagreements in life. It doesn't matter what disagreement you have with somebody, even if they are your God connection, don't disconnect. Just work through things. Can you say amen? We need to do that in life. It's so important for us to understand that. Devil would love to disconnect us. Here's a scripture. I don't know if you've ever seen it in the Bible. You might have not. In Ecclesiastes 9:4 it says this: for to him that is joined to all the living there is hope. To him that is joined or connected to the living there's all hope. For a living dog is better than a dead lion. What is that saying to us? It's saying a connected dog is better than a disconnected lion. I don't know if you know about lions. You know they're the most powerful animal, the king of the jungle. But you know, if you take a lion away from its surrounding and its family of lionesses, he becomes useless. He can't survive. And what it's saying here is this: it doesn't matter where your life is today. Because sometimes we gauge our lives against people we think are doing so great. We think sometimes we're not much in life. But let me say this: a living dog connected is better than a dead lion. Can you say amen? Amen. So I'd rather be a living connected dog than a disconnected lion. Can you say amen tonight? We need to understand that. You know, the devil, let me say this to you, and I make no bones about this tonight. The devil would love to break your God connection. He'd love to do that. Jesus speaks about things in the Bible. And he speaks about marriage in the context of marriage, but there's a lot of things he speaks about. And one of the things that disconnects people is the hardness of heart. When people's hearts start getting hard. You see, when you start seeing things that you've never seen before and something goes in your heart, you better check your heart. Because the only thing that has changed is your heart. Jesus talks about it and he says this in Mark chapter 10 verses 2 to 9. If we read it out of the Word of God, it says this: when he spoke to the Pharisees that came to him, they asked him, is it lawful for a man to put away his wife tempting him? And he answered and said unto them, didn't Moses command you? What did Moses command you? And they said, Moses suffered us to write the bill of divorcement and to put her away. And Jesus answered and said unto them, for the hardness of your heart, you've wrote this precept. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife, connect to his wife. And they twain shall be one flesh, so that they are no more twain, but one flesh. Now listen to this verse 9. It says, therefore what God has joined together, don't let any man put asunder. Whatever, it says, whatever therefore God has joined together. He might be speaking in the context of marriage there, but it speaks about everything. If God's connected you to this church, don't let anybody come and separate you from your church. Because you'll always have somebody in the church that's unhappy, and they want to spread their unhappiness. But don't let them do that. Because what God's joined you to, don't let anybody break it. Amen. Such a powerful hardness of heart. Speaks about marriage, and we can understand this, how powerful connection and disconnection is if you look at marriage. When people in marriages, you see, basically divorce all starts in the root of selfishness. And then when selfishness doesn't get its way, it hardens its heart. And you see what happens is this, is when people that are married and have children start getting divorced. Now listen, I'm not picking on the divorced, okay? Preaching on a principle. God loves you tonight. If you have been divorced, He loves you. Can you say amen? My wife has been divorced, and or her husband died, and this is a second husband. Can you say amen? But I'm proud to tell you it's my first wife. Some of you said, are you thinking about a second? Not in your lifetime. This one has taken everything I have. Hallelujah. Can you say amen? And you watch it. You see, when a husband and wife get so caught up in their selfishness, they get divorced, the kids suffer, disconnection comes. The disconnection comes and separates the father and the mother. It separates their love as children for the father and for the mother. And then what happens is this, they continue it into a next generation. You know, I did was marrying a couple a few weeks ago. And while I was going through the pre-marriage and talking to them about it, their parents were in our church for years. And I said, isn't it so wonderful that you've been connected to parents that have put such a wonderful example into your life? And they said, yes, Pastor, it's wonderful. And I said to them, I'm telling you now, you will never get divorced because you've had the right example. And the girl turned around and said to me this, you know, Pastor, you're right. Because my mother's sister, she's got divorced a few times, and she said this, and every one of her children have been divorced. So see how disconnection, how it can destroy because of hardness of heart. Check your heart. Check your heart. Can you say amen? You've got to check your heart so you don't allow your heart to become hard in the things of life. The other thing that happens to people is this, is that people disconnect because of strife. You know, one of the things that has amazed me in my life about strife is that if you speak about somebody long enough and badmouth them long enough, even if it's behind their back, spiritually you cut the connection. You cut it. I've had that happen to me many times in my life. I've had people that have been around me and they've spoken about me, and all of a sudden at some time or another they come into my presence and I can sense the connection's broken. You see, if you can allow strife to disconnect you from your godly connection or any other connection. How many of you know in families it's amazing that this brother doesn't speak to this brother or this sister to that sister? And it seems like in every family you've got somebody that don't want to talk to somebody. I mean, it's just one of those things. Strife, what a terrible thing that comes. And it tells us this, that strife is not a good thing, because 1 Corinthians 15:33 says, don't be deceived, for evil communication corrupts good manners. And people will come in and they'll cause strife and cause things to happen. The other thing that happens is the devil uses, this is his champion thing, to disconnect you from godly connection and good connection in your life. That's offenses. He'll get you offended at something. You know, how many of you know people get offended at everything? They get offended at the robot when it goes red. They get offended at the president. They get offended at the government. They get offended at the person, how they looked at them when they come here. So some people are so prone to offense that you don't even want to talk to them. You're scared to talk to them. Because they might just get offended because you speak to them. Amen. It's amazing. how people get offended, and it always amazes me. And we shouldn't allow ourselves to be offended, because offenses will come. I want you to know, somebody is going to do something to you. He's going to try and offend you. I just want to encourage you as a pastor today. When an offense comes, don't pick it up. Just throw it aside and let it go, man. Let it go. Don't pick it up. Let it go. Stay connected. Stay connected. Hallelujah. The other thing that I find today has become a very strong thing that disconnects people, and that's distractions. Especially from the house that God plants them. How people get distracted. It's so easy to get distracted. You know, we remember the story. We all know the story about the prodigal son. He was in his father's house. And that's the type of the father's house, the church and the world. And how he heard about the things that are happening downtown. The music and the drink and all the stuff that's going on. And he thought, I want to go party. And so he took whatever was his and he left his father's house. He left his father's house. In other words, he disconnected from his father. He disconnected from him. I'm so glad we have a loving father. Even when we disconnect from God, he says, come on back, man. Hallelujah. Doesn't matter what you've done, just come on back here. He just wants you back all the time. Can you say amen? And we need to understand that the disconnection by distraction is very important. You know, I was reading in a psalm, and this really caught me. This psalm was the psalm of one of Korah's sons. Korah was one of the persons that wrote many of the psalms. And it talks about how the son was disconnected. And let me read this to you out of Psalms 42 verses 4. It says, he writes this. He says, you know, my heart is broken as I remember how I used to be. I walked among the crowds of worshippers, leading a great procession to the house of God, singing with joy and giving thanks amidst the sound of great celebration. Just like we are here tonight. How many of you know? What is he saying here? He's saying this. He says, when we come to church, he says, when I come to the house of God, I'm one of the first ones there. I stand in the front and I champion everybody. Let's praise the Lord. Let's praise the Lord. And he speaks about that in his heart. His heart is crying out, and he says this. I want to read it to you out of the Message Bible. It says this. He says, these are the things I go over and over, emptying out the pockets of my life. I was already heading for the worshiping crowd. I used to head up the worshiping crowd right in front, leading them all the way, eager to arrive and worship at God. Shouting praises, singing, giving thanks, celebrating for us God's feast. What he's doing is crying out. And he's saying, I've disconnected myself. I got distracted from God's house. And he's saying, I remember the days how full of joy I was. How I used to unreservedly worship and praise the Lord and love God. He says, but now I find myself disconnected. I empty out the pockets of my mind and my soul, thinking about those days. But thank God, he cries out to God over and over. Verse 8, he says, but each day the Lord pours his unfailing love upon me. And through each night I sing the songs, praising and praying to God who gives me life. He prayed, God, connect me. And I thank God that he got connected again. Can you say amen? Amen. He got connected again. But you know what? There's nothing like being in the house of God. There's nothing like being connected to God's house. Can you say amen? Amen. Hallelujah. I love. How many of you know the psalmist said? He said, I was glad when they said, let us go to the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. You know, we should be the most joyful, shouting, happy Christians when we come to church. Not the guys that say, well, it's church again, you know. You know, I'm here again. You know, my wife, if it wasn't for her, I wouldn't be a pastor tonight. Oh, I shouldn't have said that. Sorry, guys. No, we should be full of joy. God's house. Hallelujah. This is the best house. God's house. Can you say amen? Let me just talk about the blessings of God connections and then I'll finish. I don't have my time. The God connections. In Psalm 92, this is one of my favorite psalms in the Bible. And I love the psalm. It says this in Psalm 92:12. The uncompromisingly righteous shall flourish like the palm tree. They'll be long-lived, stately, upright, useful and fruitful. They shall grow like cedars in Lebanon, majestic, stable, durable and incorruptible. Planted in the house of the Lord, they shall flourish in the courts of our God, growing in grace. They shall still bring forth fruit in their old age. Praise God, Giles. Hallelujah. I'm right behind you. Hallelujah. Can you say amen? I don't know why they put the old age thing there, but anyway. They shall be full of sap. That means spiritual vitality and rich in the vigor of trust, love and contentment. They are living memorials to show the Lord is upright, faithful to His promise. He's my rock and there's no unrighteousness in Him tonight. Can you say amen? Planted in the house. What does it mean to be planted in the house? Being planted in a house doesn't mean coming to church occasionally every Sunday. Planted in the house means you are part of the life source of the house. You love the house. You're connected to the house. You serve in the house. Can you say amen? Connection. Jesus speaks. Paul speaks about the body of Christ being connected. How can the ear say to the mouth, I don't need you, and the eye to the nose, I don't need you? No, we need one another. Connection. And it talks about us being part of the body that every joint supplies. You know, when you're connected to the house and you're planted in the house, you're involved in the church. You're part of the heartbeat of the church. You're excited about the house. Can you say amen? And that's what it means when it speaks about being planted in the house of God, is where you're connected and you love the house and you flourish in the house. The greatest pension you could ever get or old age policy you could get is be planted in the house of the Lord and you'll still flourish in your old age. Can you say amen? Planting a sow. Be planted in the right place. You know, we're in a season, and you probably have it here, where the summer's coming and everything. And, you know, I've noticed this sometimes when we buy plants. I don't know if you do this, but I do it. Jesus needs to help me. You know, you go and you buy a plant that says full sun. And then you say, you know, it'll look nicer, but there's a bit of shade here. And then you plant it there, against the instruction. And then you plant it and you put water year after year and the thing goes, and it stops there. Doesn't grow. You know why? Because it's not planted in the right place. But if you take that plant and you go put it in the sun and you put a little bit of water, in no time, it grows. Because it's planted in the right place. Tonight I want to ask you, as we close, where's your God connection? Because when you're connected to your God connection, listen to me, your life must be fruitful, it must become stable, it must increase, and there must be spiritual vitality in your life when you're planted in God's house. Can you say amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Father, we thank you tonight. Thank you tonight for every person in this place tonight. Thank you that you love them. That's why Jesus came. He came to connect with us, to connect with us, taking our sin and going through all the things that we go through so that He could save us. I pray for every man and woman tonight whose life, Father, is just in a place where they don't feel connected, they don't belong, no sense of belonging in their lives. I pray for them tonight, that tonight they'll find their destiny in Christ, that they'll find their worth in Jesus tonight, that they'll be saved tonight and the fullness of God will come and dwell in their lives tonight. I thank you for every man, every woman in this place tonight. Can I ask you, while every head is bowed, every eye is closed tonight, if you're sitting here tonight, if you say, Pastor, you know, I know what you're saying tonight. I can't say that I'm connected to God. I know I'm not connected to people of God around me. Will you pray for me tonight? Tonight you can come into Christ. You can get connected. He's the vine. And you can be grafted into that vine tonight. and let Jesus be part of your life. Right now, while every head is bowed, every eye is closed, if you're here tonight and you'll say, will you include me in the prayer? We're going to pray a prayer. If you want to be included in that prayer, I'm going to ask you right now just to raise your hand. Once you put it up, you can put it down. Just right now, if you're here. Thank you, ma'am. You can put that hand down. Thank you, I see that hand. Thank you, I see that hand. Thank you so much. Thank you, I see the hand over there. God bless you tonight. Anybody else will say this. Jesus loves you tonight. You just come to Him like you are, and He changes your life around. Is there anybody else that will say, pray for me tonight? Thank you, sir. God bless you. God bless you. Thank you, Jesus. The love of God tonight is on your life. He loves you tonight. He's come to save you so you can have a better life tonight. If there's anybody else that will say, let's join those people. Thank you, sir. God bless you. God bless you. Thank you, ma'am. God bless you over there. God bless you tonight. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm going to land it over to Pastor Larry right now. Amen.
Let's just stay in the attitude of prayer. If you lifted up your hand this evening, and even if you didn't, but you felt a tugging in your heart, and you want to accept Jesus into your heart as your Lord and Savior, we're going to pray a prayer in a moment from Romans chapter 10. The whole church is going to pray it out aloud with you. And if you'll just repeat that prayer, just mean it from your heart sincerely, God will meet you right where you are. Can we do that together? Let's say, Father God, I come to you tonight and I thank you for your Son Jesus, that He died on the cross of Calvary and that you raised Him from the dead so that I could be saved. I receive Jesus into my heart tonight as my Lord and Savior, and I thank you that tonight my life has changed. I'm born again and I'm a child of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you prayed that prayer tonight, we are so excited. Let's give the Lord a praise and thanksgiving tonight in this place. We still have a couple of things we need to take care of this evening, and we decided to do things a little bit differently tonight in terms of the ceremony side of our auditorium and of our festivities this evening. But before we do that, you know, it's so awesome when God moves in people's lives. And how many know we serve a God tonight who answers prayer? And we had a gentleman come to one of the homes that we're associated with. They're part of this church called the Summerlee Trust. Works with people with special needs. People who have experienced difficulties in their lives and that have caused them to come into a situation. And so Cyril came to our Summerlee Trust home about 5 weeks ago. He'd had a stroke and he was unable to walk, unable to move, and he was in a wheelchair. And I believe he wants to just demonstrate something to us tonight after 5 weeks of good prayer and good healthy therapy. He has started taking a couple of steps and walking and moving. He's able to use his hands and his arms again. And that's the power of prayer. Isn't that amazing? We went to fetch him in a Mamzon Toady 5 weeks ago. We had to carry him and pick him up and put him into the car. He couldn't walk, couldn't move. And in 5 weeks, prayer and lots of love and care makes all the difference. Amen. Let's give Jesus praise tonight. Uncle Cyril, we're so proud of you. Keep going. And we believe you're going to make a full recovery. Amen. Not bad for 80-something years. Amen. You see, he wants to get up here and preach tonight. So just for a moment, I want every head bowed, every eye closed. If you're here tonight and you have sickness in your body or you're facing an unsurmountable challenge in your life, you've heard the word preached tonight, and we want to pray and release our faith with you. So if you need healing in your body in any area of your life, or you need to trust God for a breakthrough, would you simply, while every head is bowed, every eye is closed, just lift up your hand, and we're going to release our faith tonight in agreement. Thank you, Lord. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for every person that's responded tonight. And we release our faith tonight in the name of Jesus. And we pray tonight, Father God, that you would cause healing to come into their bodies, that you'll cause restoration to come into their relationships, Father. That whatever financial challenge that they might be facing tonight, Father God, we release our faith with theirs in agreement tonight, that you would work in that situation, and that you will cause miracles, signs and wonders to take place in their lives, and that through that, your name will be lifted up. We give you thanks and we give you praise for that tonight, in Jesus' name. Name. Amen. Hallelujah. We believe it's done in your life. We believe God is doing a work in your life tonight. Can you say amen?
I really believe that the Lord is directing me to do this right now before we go. I want to ask Pastor Larry and Mandy to stay, and I'll ask Don Phillips and his wife to come, and Chris and Brenda, if you will. I just feel, Don, if you can pray over Mandy and Larry tonight in the church. God's got great things ahead for this church. Hallelujah. Come, Laurel, let's stand over here. Amen.
Let us pray. Father, I want to thank you tonight for the promises you've given us in your word, that whatever we ask in your name, it shall be done for us. And tonight, Lord, we're praying specifically for our brother, our sister, for the work that you've called them to do, the anointing upon their lives, the ability to function in a manner that's pleasing to you. And tonight, Lord, we know that your anointing breaks every yoke, destroys all forms of bondages. And tonight, even as they speak the word, you will anoint that word. And that, Lord, bondages will be removed and yokes will be destroyed. That, Father, where there is darkness, light will come. And that, Lord, where there is hopelessness, you will restore hope. Broken pieces will come together again. We speak that which is in your heart over their lives, and we agree by faith that, Lord, you will take them to another level, as we heard from Pastor Tony, even tonight, in the name of Jesus. We pray for this congregation that, Lord, they are a light, they are the salt, they are a house on the hilltop, for such a time as this. And we bless them, Father. Everything their hands touch, let it be blessed of God, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you so much. All right, are we all good? In preparing for our greater night, the team decided to have a closing ceremony, because the end of tonight's celebration is actually the beginning of a new season in our local church. We're going to cut the ribbon tonight from the inside of God's house, releasing you to move out into the world. And as we light the lanterns tonight, it's symbolic of our lives being released as light into the darkness.
1 Corinthians 9:19 says, "For though I am free from all, I have made myself a servant to all, that I might win them all." Our mission here on Rhema South Coast is at your service. We are aiming to reach the South Coast for Jesus, 120 kilometers along the coastline and 40 kilometers inland, to bring Jesus to the brokenhearted, the poor and the widowed. With the help of each and every person who understands that salvation is a gift and believes in this vision, we follow the commission to enlarge the kingdom of Christ on the South Coast. We love God our Father, therefore we care for his people, reaching out to the homeless and bringing hope and destiny to those who are lost. We are a harbor for those on the journey of life, sailing for the cause of the kingdom, carrying the treasured cargo of God's word to the world. For those who have been shipwrecked and battered from the storms of life, who come to the safety of our shores, they can be restored and rebuilt, making it possible for them to raise their sails higher. as God charts a new course for their lives, with Jesus as their captain and the Holy Spirit as their compass, enabling us all to do greater than before.
Tonight we have asked Sean and Belinda to cut the ribbon and to open this new season in our local church. They've been part of this vision, as many others have, since its inception 8 years ago. They were single at the time and have now been married and are still volunteering in the local church. Sean and Belinda, would I ask you please to move to the back to the doors. Tonight is a very special occasion. We're not only celebrating our 8th birthday, exactly 8 years ago, the 2nd of October 2005, this local church opened its doors. But tonight, we are officially opening our very own brand new campus. And so I'm going to ask all of you to please stand together, and if you'd like to turn towards those doors. We're going to ask Sean and Belinda to cut the ribbon as we declare tonight Rhema South Coast Family Church new campus officially opened. Let's give a cheer for Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woo!